In this video, we look at a simple way to model the population dynamics of one species of animal. For example, these marbled white butterflies. Rather than biological accuracy, our aim is to show that simple mathematical models can have very complicated behavior. A key feature of the models we'll build is that the species in question has a one-year life cycle. The butterflies emerge as caterpillars in spring, then pupate to become butterflies and lay eggs in summer, and by autumn the butterflies have perished and their eggs become next spring's caterpillars. Mathematically, we can ignore all these peculiar biological details. The point is that there is exactly one generation of butterflies per year. So we can get a fairly complete picture of the population dynamics by counting their number once a year. To predict the number of butterflies next year, our model will rely purely on the number of butterflies this year. If the number of butterflies this year is x, then our model will give the number next year as f of x, where the function f is called the update function. If we denote the number of butterflies in year number n by x sub n, then our model states that the population in year n plus 1, so x sub n plus 1, equals f of x sub n. Such repeated application of the same function is called iteration. For example, we could assume that for every butterfly this year, there will be two the next. Then the update function f is given by f of x equals 2x. So if the initial population the first year is x1, then the population the second year, x2, will equal 2 times x1, x3 will equal 4 times x1, x4 8 times x1, and so on. This is a perfect example of exponential growth. It may be a good model if the population is small compared to the available food and other resources, but clearly a population can't keep growing like this forever. A more realistic choice for the update function would be such that high numbers one year lead to low numbers the next, because there would not be enough food to sustain a population that large. We can achieve this by multiplying our previous update function f by the factor 1 minus x, so that now f of x equals 2 times x times 1 minus x. Although here x is not the number of butterflies, but rather a number between 0 and 1, representing the fraction of the maximum conceivable number of butterflies that is currently present. The closer x gets to its maximum value of 1, the closer to zero the factor 1 minus x becomes. So this update function is indeed such that a large population size one year will be followed by a small population size the next. Its graph, as you can see on the right, is hump-shaped. This function f is called the logistic map. The number 2 in it still indicates that for a very small population, the number of individuals would double each year. It could just as well triple, quadruple, or change by any other factor. So really we want to replace this number 2 by a parameter r that can take different values. To study the population dynamics of the logistic map, let's make a plot of population over time on the left of our screen. We start with some initial population size, and then use this as x value on the right-hand plot. Find the y value assigned to it by the logistic map and transfer this new value to the left-hand plot, marking the population size at the next point in time. Then we bring this new value to the x-axis of the right-hand plot and repeat the process. This way we obtain the graph of a sequence of values produced by the iteration. We call such sequences solutions because they solve an equation. The equation xn plus 1 is equal to f of xn. Each such solution is fully determined by the initial population size, the number it starts with, and the update function f, which we take here to be the logistic map. On the right-hand plot, it's a little bit awkward to have to transfer each value from the y-axis back to the x-axis. We can do this in a more graphically pleasing way by moving the point on the graph to the diagonal instead of to the y-axis. Tracing this movement, so alternating a vertical move through the plot and a horizontal move to the diagonal, we can obtain a visualization of the dynamics known as a cobweb diagram. The shape of the cobweb diagram and the ultimate fate of our butterflies depends on the value of the constant r in the logistic map. If r is 1 or less, then the population size decreases in every step and eventually converges to 0, meaning that the butterflies will die out, unfortunately. The cobweb diagram here is a staircase with smaller and smaller steps, slowly descending to the origin. If r is between 1 and 3, then the population size converges to a non-zero value. The cobweb diagram, in this case, can jump about a little at the start, but eventually it also becomes a staircase, approaching the point where the diagonal intersects the plot of the logistic map. If r is slightly more than 3, then there isn't one stable population size. Instead, the iteration settles in an oscillation between two values. We say that such a pattern has period 2, or call it 2-periodic, because it repeats itself every two steps. The cobweb diagram, in this case, if we ignore the initial bits, is a square. If we increase r a little bit more, the iteration settles into a 4-periodic pattern. The cobweb diagram now somehow resembles two interlinked squares. Increasing r even further, the dynamics becomes chaotic. It never settles into a repeating pattern. And the cobweb diagram, well, it's a mess. The transition from periodically oscillating solutions to chaos as the parameter r increases is full of magic. It's often visualized by a bifurcation diagram, like this one. For each value of r on the horizontal axis, it shows the values a solution takes after it has been given time to settle. So if there is one point, this is the value the solution converges to. If there are two points above each other, the solution will oscillate between these two values. If there are four points, the solution settles into a 4-periodic pattern, and so on. And if there are many points scattered all over the place, then the solution is chaotic. This gives a visual representation of how the behavior changes at certain values of r. Many videos could be made about this bifurcation diagram, and indeed, many have been, so I'll link to some in the description. In the next video, we'll focus on a slightly different question. Why does chaos happen at all? And we'll find that chaos is not unusual. In fact, it's a mathematical necessity if the update map satisfies a simple condition.